How good the Lord is. Blessings to each of you. Indeed, we're grateful to God once again to have this opportunity to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I want to remind you to mark your calendars for the first Sunday in June. The first Sunday in June, we're having a baptismal and Lord's Supper service on that evening at 5 o'clock, celebrating all of those members who they gave their life to Christ and connected with the church during the pandemic and even up to now here in 2022. So it's going to be a great day and a great evening of worship. So mark your calendars for June the 5th at 5 o'clock p.m. Again, thank you so much for taking the time out to join us in this virtual space this morning. I want to ask you to do me a favor. I want you to share this worship service because someone may not get a word. They may not be in a position to get into a sanctuary, but use this tool of social media to share with someone so that perhaps they can join in or they can go back and be a part of the worship experience at a later time. I want you to get your Bibles out and get prepared to go with us again to Luke chapter 15. We have been studying Luke chapter 15, talking about love for the lost. I talked about the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son. Now we're talking about the lost sibling. In Luke chapter 15, commencing the reading this morning at verse 25, going through verse 32, it is this elder brother who is representative of the Pharisees and the scribes. The younger brother who has squandered all of his possessions, he comes back home. The father receives him, throws a party. The elder son is in the field. As he comes back, he hears the party. He hears all of the excitement, the singing, and the dancing. And he calls the servant to him to find out what's going on and start asking a litany of questions. And he's upset. The father comes out, pleads with him to come inside and join the party. But the elder son rejects that request because he feels, I've been with you. I've been working. And you never gave me anything like this. But the reality of it is, this passage ends in an open-ended way. The Bible does not tell us whether the son ever went in or did he stay out. And I think God is trying to tell us that as we reach out to the lost, we can always change the narrative. We have the ability to determine how their story ends. So I want you to get your notes ready so that you can follow along and be a part of what God is doing in this preaching moment so that you can study it beyond that time and grow in your walk in the Word of God. Listen, I love you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. Our music ministry is about to bless us momentarily. If you would, go to God in prayer with me. Gracious God, we say thank you. Thank you, Lord, for another day. Thank you for the bounty of blessings you have so richly given to us. We pray now, God, that you would bless us as we encounter you in this worship experience. We love you, God, for who you are. It is in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, that we offer this prayer. And every child of God said, amen. God bless you. Let's worship the Lord. good the Lord is. Blessings to you once again. Thanks to our music ministry for blessing us and leading us so wonderfully into the presence of the Lord. I want to now invite you to prepare your hearts and your minds as we give our gifts unto the Lord. On the screen, there are multiple ways that you can give, but I want you to remember this is about your love for God. Give because you love God. Give because you know who God is to you in your life. So I want you to give your best gifts unto the Lord. Be a blessing and make sure that you honor God and honor God's word. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we say thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give back to you a portion of what you have given unto us. God, help us be good stewards of that which you own. God, I pray now that you would bless both hand and heart of each giver. And I pray that none would lack because of their gift. It is in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, that we offer this prayer. And every child of God said, amen. We give because we love the Lord and because we believe in kingdom building. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me now to Luke chapter 15, Luke chapter 15, and I want to commence the reading at verse number 25, verse 25 of Luke chapter 15. Hear the word of God as it speaks to us. Now his older son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. And he summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what these things could be. He said to him, your brother has come and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, look, so many years I have been serving you and I have never neglected a command of yours. And yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you have always been with me, and all the time, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live, and was lost and has been found. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be unto our God. We've been talking about love for the lost. In this particular message, I want to tag this love for the lost sibling. Love for the lost sibling. As we look back at chapter 15, again, you have to go back a bit to even the end of chapter 14. It connects to Jesus saying, those who have an ear, let them hear. Chapter 15, we see in verse 1, the tax collectors and the sinners are coming to Jesus. And they are coming to him, as the text says, to listen to him. They want to hear what he has to say. As they are coming to him, these tax collectors and sinners who are problematic people because of the life they live, the Pharisees and the scribes, these religious people, they start to grumble and they are complaining because Jesus is entertaining them. Jesus is giving them space. He's allowing them to come near him. They have a problem. So it prompts Jesus to start to share these parables. He goes into the first parable, talks about shepherd has 100 sheep. One is lost. Shepherd leaves the 99 to go find that one lost sheep. He finds that lost sheep, places it on his shoulders, brings the sheep back to the house, calls family and friends together, and requires a celebration, said that which was lost has now been found. He moves from that moment in verses 1 through 7 to verses 8 through 10, where there's a woman who has 10 coins. She loses one, and She has to turn on a light and sweep around to find that one lost coin. She finds the one lost coin. She calls the friends and the family together to celebrate over that one lost coin that had been found. He moves then from the sheep to the lost coin, and in verses 11 through 24, he has this boy. This father has two sons, and an older son and a younger son. The younger son comes to the father and tells the father, give me all that is due unto me. I want my inheritance. Now, the father's still alive. The father's still in his right mind. But the boy asks for his stuff. And when he asks for his stuff, his father gives it to him. He obliges him. He gives it to him. And the boy takes his estate, that part which is his. And he goes to a far country, and he lives a loose life. And in living a loose life, a famine shows up. The boy has spent all that he had. Now he is destitute, and he has to go find a citizen to give him a job. And he finds himself working in a pig pen. He's in a hog pen, and in that hog pen, he sees how hogs are eating, and he, in essence, says, I'd be better off if I would go back home. I could at least be a servant in my daddy's house. He comes to himself. As he comes to himself, he goes back to his father's house, and his father welcomes him and receives him. But it's in this section of this chapter that the father was happy, but the brother was not. The brother is the one that we're going to focus on this morning. The brother has a problem that his baby brother, his younger brother, has been out living it up, and he comes back and the daddy celebrates him. Has a problem. The brother is indicative of scribes and the Pharisees. What we discover is in this chapter, God has love for the lost, and he teaches us that we ought to have a concern for the lost. What this helps us to understand is that this text is a message for both the unsaved and the saved, because some folk are religious but have no relationship. Some folk are resource sensitive but not relationship sensitive. They're in the church but not in Christ. For the saved, it would suggest some are just like this elder brother. They'd rather grumble than be grateful. They'd rather pout than party, rather complain than celebrate. So the message is rich and right and relevant for any of us who understands the importance of loving the lost. God has a high value on the lost. He constantly shows us in this text how significant it is for us to seek those who are lost. But It's this brother who is a spitting image of the scribes and the Pharisees, shows how they responded when the publicans or the tax collectors and the sinners came to Jesus. They were upset. They didn't feel that they deserved to be a part of what God was doing. They didn't want them there. So it is this boy who represents them. And a few things I want us to look at. First of all, I want to consider his position. I want to consider his problem and consider his plea. The plea, the position, the problem, and the plea. Verse 25, the A portion of the text, is intriguing in that gives us some insight about the boy's position. Notice what verse 25 says in the text. When you look at the A portion of verse 25, it says, now his older brother was in the field. That right there says something about this boy's position. He is in a privileged position. He's in a privileged position as the older brother because he has access to all now that the father has left. The younger brother has taken his part, squandered it, but this brother, everything that's there, it's due unto him. He has this privileged position. The scribes and the Pharisees had this privileged position. were of the household of the Jews, and they were people who were religious. They were people who had unique access, privileged position. But the boy also, as we look in the text, not only does he have a privileged position as being the oldest son, but he has a productive position because it says he's in the field. We see this boy, and if you look at this part of the text, you see a boy who seems not to have any issues. He's the oldest son. He's working. He's doing the work of his father. He's serving. He's working. Seems that if he's a productive young man, but when we keep reading the text, it shows us that in spite of his privileged position, in spite of his productive position, the boy has problems. See, the oldest son, he represents these religious legalists, the scribes and the Pharisees. See, what you have to know about them, outwardly, they lived a blameless life, but inwardly, their attitude was shameful and abominable. What we notice is that this was the true oldest son. He it was true of him. He worked hard. He obeyed his father. He brought no disgrace to the family. He brought no disgrace to the townspeople. He was outwardly the image that you would want. He was outwardly the perfect person. He was outwardly everything right. There are religious people who are outwardly. They do everything right. They look the part. They say the right stuff. They do the right things, but it's something that's happening on the inside. And as we move through the text, we will see that the boy has problems, and the problem is found in the B portion of verse 25 through 30. Watch what the text says. It says, "And when he came and approached the house, he heard the music and the dancing, and he summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what these things could be. He said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, and he has received him back and safe. He's safe and sound.' But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, 'Look, so many years I have been serving you, and I have never neglected a command of yours, and yet you have never given me as much as a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. When this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.'" Problem the boy has is, first of all, with the rejoicing. He's coming back from the field, and it has to tell you that it's a pretty large state, because he was not aware of all of those people that had shown up. So he gets back to the house and he hears this music. And he hears all of the commotion and sees dancing. They're dancing in a circle, celebratory. The boy has a problem with the rejoicing. And many of us are just like this boy. We don't want the party to take place, because the party is placing the light on somebody else. So the boy, he's asking questions, and the text says he inquires of the servant, and he didn't just ask one question. He starts to interrogate the servant, trying to figure out what's going on and who's in the house. Why are they celebrating? What's the music? Why is all of the dancing? Want to know what's going on. And his problem is not only with the rejoicing, but it's with the return, because the servant says, "Your brother has shown back up, and he's safe and sound." And he's not excited that his brother, who had walked out, who had left, and he'd returned. Just like the Pharisees and the scribes, they were not excited to see these people coming. But then it's not only the rejoicing, it's not only the return, but it's the reception. Because in the text, this word "received," it pictures the father receiving this prodigal son with no strings attached. It's the father's full essence of grace and welcome back to home for the boy, that the elder brother, it fuels the fire and the anguish that's inside of him. He's mad. He's furious. That how is it that this boy has my brother, and he doesn't even call him his brother. He says, your that son of yours, how is it that I've been here? I've been working. I've been doing all of this. I've worked. I've obeyed you. I've done everything right. Same as if the Pharisees and the scribes are simply saying, we've kept every law, we've kept every command, we've done everything that's in their mind, but they've not kept every single one, but we've done everything right. We are the picture of perfection. We are the picture of perfection. Why would you want to spend time with those sinners and those tax collectors? We are the picture of perfect religion, perfect righteousness, but you choose to mess with those folk who have a bad and negative past. And that's how this boy is. Dad, I've been at the house. I've worked, because now it's suggesting that my relationship with you, Father, is not based upon grace, but it's based upon how much I do. And beloved, I want to say this as a parenthetical note. Our relationship with the Father is not based upon how good and how much we work. It is a relationship that is based upon the grace of God, the love of God. The boy says, I've been here. And he says, you didn't even as much give me a goat, which would be a cheaper, diminished animal. He says, but you give him the fattened calf. I mean, you give him the filet mignon, and you didn't even offer me no sardines and crackers. I mean, you didn't give me anything. You have given him the best, and he's been squandering he devoured all that you had on prostitutes and partying and living this kind of life. Well, the truth of the matter is, the boy never asked his father to give him a party. The boy never asked for a celebration, but he has a problem that the father has received this boy. He had the problem with the reception. Let me say this, beloved. Everybody will not be happy to see when you get your life right with God. Everybody is not happy to see you make the change. Everybody won't be happy to see how you come to your senses and come back to God and get your life right. Some will be just like this elder brother. In fact, the question is, how many of us have been just like this boy? God does something in someone else's life, blesses them, and we start to look with the eye of envy. We start to get upset. We won't celebrate. We won't join the party. We won't say the name. We won't lift him up. We turn our nose up. We don't say anything. We look funny because we don't want to give any shine to them. Father makes a request. Father goes out, pleads with the son. Come in. Come join the party. Your brother who was lost, he's now found. Your brother who had left, he has come back. Now, culturally speaking, it was the responsibility of the elder son to help mend relationships with the father. But this boy, in his self-righteousness, in his own mindset, he's not fooling with him. He's not dealing with him. And it shows us how he viewed the brother and how he valued the brother. The question I raise to us is, how do you view those that God changes their life? How do you value those whom God has changed their life? Do you still look at them and bring up the past? Because notice, the boy is back home. He is back home. Now you have to understand, by the time we get here in the text, he's robed, he has his ring on, he has shoes on. He looks just like a son. He doesn't look like a servant. He doesn't look like he's been out in the field. He doesn't look like he's been living a riotous life. But he looks like somebody that the father has cleaned up and covered. And how this boy views him, he views him based upon his past, not his present. How many of us are guilty of viewing people and valuing people based upon the past and not the present? If the truth be told, all of us have a past, and I thank God that the Lord doesn't hold our past against us, and I thank God that he has given us a productive present. But how many of us are guilty of being just like this elder brother? Then the father pleads with the boy, Verse 28, he pleads. Get to verse 31, verse 32. Watch what he says. It says, and he said to him, son, you've always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. He says, but we had to celebrate, and we had to rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live, and was lost and has been found. The father's plea is a plea of purpose. He says to the boy, there's a purpose for you to come in. The purpose is for you to celebrate with your brother. The purpose would be for you to celebrate that he's no longer lost. He's no longer a living dead man, but he has shown up back home. That the purpose is that you are, I'm pleading with you because there's purpose in my plea. I want you to be a part of the celebration. I don't want you to pout, but I want you to party. I don't want you to complain, but I want you to celebrate. He says, but the plea has perspective. Look at verse 31, the A portion, it has perspective in the sense that he says, he said to him, son, you've always been with me. He says, you've been with me. And since you've been with me, you have to understand you've always had this position. And that's the problem with the scribes and the Pharisees. They've been right there. So they should have been different. They should have viewed things different. He says, it's a plea of perspective. You've been with me. But then it's a plea with promise, because if you notice in the text, watch what he says. He says in verse 31, be all that is mine is yours. Listen, the father is telling the son, everything I have, it's yours. There's no reason for you not to party. He can't get anything from you. He's not taking anything from you. Why would you not celebrate? Do you know that there are people right now that you're not taking anything from them, but they can't celebrate you because what you're being celebrated for, since it's not them, they can't celebrate with you. This boy cannot celebrate because he feels that he's better than his younger brother. The Pharisees and the scribes felt that they were better than the tax collectors and the sinners, and they refused to come in and party. This boy refuses to come in and party, but it's a plea of precedence. Father says, but we had to celebrate, we had to rejoice. We need some people who talk like this, Father. We need some people who have a have to celebrate and have to rejoice type perspective, that when someone has been lost, he says in the text, he says, this is your brother who was dead. But watch what he says. He says, and now he has begun to live. In essence, he's saying he was dead, but he's begun to live. He's made a turnaround. He's made a change, and that's why you ought to celebrate. He says we had to celebrate, because when he showed up, he was muddy. He was in a mess. He was looking like he didn't know which way to go. He admitted that he messed up. He says, but I didn't care. I'm just glad that he's home, and we had to celebrate. I wish I had some folk in here with me this morning watching this, and you could say, we just have to celebrate. I wish we would have a have to celebrate, have to rejoice moment when we realize someone who was lost, they've now been found. Someone who was messed up, God put them on the right track. Someone who was living in sin, God saved them. Beloved, we have to ask ourselves, who will we be like? And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be like this brother. And what I like about the text is the Lord leaves it open-ended. He doesn't tell us exactly whether the boy comes in or he stays out. He says, we had to celebrate. He leaves us right there. And I think that there's a reason he leaves us there. Because what the text says to me is that all of us at some point have to realize that God gives us the ability, yes, sir, to determine what the end of the story is going to look like. And I don't know about you, but whatever The situation is, I want to tell some parent. I want to tell some friend. I want to tell somebody who has a loved one who may be living outside of the Father's house. What the text says is that the Father was pleading with the Son, saying to the Son, Lord, you need to come in and celebrate with your brother. And I stop by to encourage somebody here this morning. You may have a son or a daughter that's in a strange place, but the text is left open-ended. And all I say to you is keep on pleading. Keep on praying, saying, Lord, will you change their situation? Lord, I don't know if the brother ever showed up in the house, but one thing I know is the Father showed up to the brother. And I stop by to tell somebody, our God is still showing up and pleading with sinners. And we must keep on pleading with sinners. We've got to keep telling them Jesus lived and Jesus saved. Is there anybody here this morning can testify with me and say, you may have somebody who's just like this lost sibling. They may be outside and won't come in to the celebration, but keep on begging, keep on pleading, telling them it's better on the inside than it is on the outside. Is there anybody here this morning can keep on testifying? So we've got to determine, will we be like this son, or will we be like the other son, show up and turn our lives over to the Lord and let God give a celebratory moment? Or will we stay on the outside? And I don't know what the final analysis of your story will be, but since I'm here this morning, I stop to tell you, you don't have to end it outside of the house. You don't have to stay outside of the house. There is joy in the house. The father was trying to get the boy to see there's joy in the house. There is blessing in the house. There's peace in the house. There's prosperity in the house. Is there anybody here want to go in the house? I remember the song said, come and go with me to my father's house. Peace, joy, and happiness is there in Chuck's, my father's house. Ooh, Lord, peace and joy is in my father's house. I'm glad that he let me come in to his house. And I stopped to tell somebody, it doesn't matter how far you've been away. It doesn't matter how bad it's been. You can go in the Father's house. There's joy. There's peace. Lord, there is
Yes, sir. Happiness in the house. And I stop to tell somebody as they go to my seat, since I've shown up in the house, he gave me joy, unspeakable joy. Yes, he did. And since he gave me joy, since I've been in the house, I resolved in my mind, I will not let anybody steal my joy, because the world didn't give it to, and the world can't take it away. This joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. The world can't take it away. Oh, Lord, thank you, Jesus. God will say thank you. Thank you, Lord, that this text shows us that even in the midst of this boy's position and problem, even his rejection of the plea, the text leaves us with an open-ended reality that we can determine what that end will be if we will simply accept the Father's invitation. God, I pray for someone this morning who does not know the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life. They will receive him, Lord and Savior of their life, and make the change. God, I pray for the person who has walked away from you, yet you still love them. You're a God of another chance. Help them to know this day can be the beginning of living their life. God, I pray for the family, man, woman, boy, or girl, who's looking for a church home to be connected with. Lord, I pray now that even in this moment, wherever they are geographically, they can make that decision to be a part of the New Mount Olive Baptist Church. We thank you, God, for who you are. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayer. It is in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, that we offer this prayer, and every child of God said, amen. Beloved, thank you so much for being a part of this worship experience this morning. I pray that the Lord would bless you and keep you, that you would have a phenomenal day. Let's go to God, prayer and our benediction. Thank you, God, for another day. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, I pray that as we leave this place, but never your presence, that you would take us and keep us and provide for us and direct us as we go about this day and week. God, I pray now that you would protect us from the evil one. Now may the grace of God rest, rule, and abide with us until we meet again. And every child of God said, amen. Let us join together in our servant leadership declaration. We, the New Mount Olive Baptist Church, are called by God to exemplify the servant leadership of Christ for the spiritual transformation of the world. I love you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. Please, ma'am, please, sir, share this worship experience so that we can get the message out to others that God is still in the saving and life-changing business. Have a great day, and may the Lord keep you in perfect peace.